and welcome to Have a Chat. I'm Audrey Lynch with my co-stars Véronique Arsenault and Judy Loge.
Hello, Audrey.
Hello, ladies.
Oh, Véronique.
Hello, we're back.
Yes, we are. For rainy Monday.
Yes, yep. Definitely. Yep. But it's still a beautiful day on the river here now because there's no more snow. That's finally gone.
The river's tomorrow.
Open.
Go with that, Audrey. Go with that.
Coming tomorrow, God willing.
Yep. Yeah, sunshine tomorrow.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, really? We've got a great show lined up for our viewers today. A couple of great guests. I'm excited about talking to a few of them. And we had a busy weekend again here in Miramichi. It has been crazy.
That was an understatement.
Everything at once, right? It doesn't rain, but it pours literally.
Okay.
Out there today.
That's just
there
it. The weather didn't keep people away.
No.
It really didn't.
There had to have been 15 things to do this weekend.
Yeah.
At least.
But we're going to start off our show today with Judy. She's up with our quote.
Yes. All right. The quote today: if people would treat themselves with the same kind of love they gave to their friends, that would be such a great gift we could give ourselves.
Very
it
true.
Would. Very we true. Do so much for other people.
We tend to be last for ourselves.
And, are you okay? And you look after you? And and I'll give you this for your headache or I'll, you know, whatever. But then we kind of put ourselves in the back burner. And if we pamper ourselves the way we do each other.
Well, I think, you get that feeling of you're selfish if you take a little bit of time for yourself.
Guilty.
I think we need to get over that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? Like if you take a night or a weekend whatever and do nothing, you have that feeling like, well, I should have done something or I, could have helped this one or whatever. And it's funny because I was talking to Mom on the weekend and it was such a busy weekend, as we said. But I said, next weekend, I have absolutely nothing scheduled. And I said, I need to take that.
Yes, you do.
And have a weekend where I don't do anything for a couple of days.
I do that. No, I'll do something. I'll have to read a book or something to qualify for not being totally a
bum.
No,
I'm okay with that.
No.
But like, you mean not leave the house, like leave your jammies on, have a nice cup of tea, and do nothing.
I'm the same as her. I looked ahead, and I'm like, there's nothing really on this schedule, and I'm getting excited.
I know.
I don't have to get that invitation.
I know. And then you feel like, I should have, or I should, or what, or you don't want to let somebody down. But I think, I think more often we need to, you can't pour from an empty cup.
No.
And that's the way you have to look at it.
You need to fill up your cup every now and again.
Revamp yourself.
Yeah. No,
I love that. I love that quote.
Well, that's by Cindy Crawford. You know that homely lady?
Yes, I know. I know.
That gorgeous lady.
And
actually,
she looks better now at 48 or 49 than she did when she was 20.
She was
And she was stunning then, but she looks better now.
She's really aging beautifully.
Yeah.
No. It's fantastic.
I want to bathe in whatever it is that she's got.
She sells some kind of product.
I know she does.
It's
true.
Well, I want to mention what I had watched. I told you ladies before that I started binge watching a new show on Netflix with Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin.
Great.
So I'm at the end of the season. I watched 13 episodes, I'm sure, in a short period of time. That's my me time. That's for me.
Love it.
And talk about beautiful.
She's 78 years old.
The two of them both are, Lily is letting her hair come in natural, doing that.
And Lily Tomlin.
I love her. Love her.
It doesn't, I love it. It it does great.
You must
her.
Love Jane Fonda's hairstyle.
Yes,
being a stylist.
I do. Yeah, I look at it and think, I have to show
it's
that to
you. It's beautiful.
Mom.
Have you seen
her
hair?
Yeah, and I mean, it's so, not only is it so becoming on her, because she looks fantastic, but it's timeless and she never looks out of date. And she hasn't made a lot of drastic changes over the number of years. She looks fantastic.
She really does. And she had a hard life. I was just reading about her last night, in fact, and she lost her mom to suicide when I believe she was only 12 years old.
Wow.
And had a rocky relationship with her father, too, Henry Fonda.
Terrible.
So. Exactly. She's had a lot of obstacles to overcome, and she certainly has.
Yeah. Incredible.
So we're the other thing that was on our mind that we didn't get to mention on a previous show was that May was Mental Health Month.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and we did want to touch on that a little bit and have a little say. You actually have a poem that you want to share.
I do, and it's
about that.
Well, and I was involved with the Schizophrenia Society for a number of years, and was the president at one point. And mental health is a real. Something that I really need to talk about more often. Yes. I want people to start talking about it more often, and it's near and dear to my heart.
Close to your heart.
Yeah, and because I think that we don't talk enough about it. We still have such an incredible stigma when it comes to mental illness.
So true.
And we need to treat it as we do any other illness.
But people are not. So
they're
you
not.
Want to drive
because
it
they
home.
Can't see it, right? They can't see that their leg is broken, or they can't, like that kind of thing. But anyway, so they asked me to be the parade marshal on Saturday for their annual
Marshal.
Yeah, I know, it was very, very official. For the annual Walk of Hope. And because the Schizophrenia Society motto is recovery is possible.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And a reason to hope, a reason to cope. And so anyway, but in all the years that I've been involved with the Schizophrenia Society, there's a lovely gentleman who writes poems for every occasion that we have. And so Fidel Gauguin Jr. actually wrote this wonderful poem. He gave me two, but I picked one of the two.
I went to school with him.
Did you really?
Yes, I did.
Did you really?
Lovely
he's
man.
Quite the poet.
Lovely
and,
man.
And he's overcome so much to be able mm-hmm. To present these every time and to express himself, and I think yes. he's just phenomenal. And so I wanted to share the poem.
Share the poem.
So it's titled Strange at Times. At times, life is so strange. I never would have thought 12 years ago that I would be giving my little talks. I thought to read poems before large crowds was out of reach. I thought I was more suited for the forest, the marsh, or the beach. But I read poems nowadays, and I do a pretty good job. I feel I've climbed a mountain, or I'm getting closer to the top. There was a time I feared life. My anxiety and panic were strong. Now I go out singing and dancing, and yes, I even engage in songs. Mm-hmm. I want to say I'm grateful. It could have gone the other way. I could still be housebound, never seeing the light of day.
Wow. That's amazing.
Love him. Love him.
Yeah,
and
beautiful.
And every time he's able to share, you know, some of the darkest times that he's had mm-hmm. and some of the lightest times that he's had. And I think he gives a voice to those who aren't able to express
that. That's so beautiful.
And, you know, in this day and age when mental health is, again, still such a stigma in our society, not just here,
we
but
know,
of course,
know.
Everywhere.
All the people that has it.
Well,
everywhere.
It's one in five.
Yes.
You know, one in five.
Yeah.
And,
that's
and we need to talk about it more. And, you know, and our viewers and you will see that I am going to talk about it a lot more because
right.
I think we need to shine some light on it.
Yes, I do too. And I agree with you totally.
Yeah.
So that's a beautiful
poem. So
Thank you, Fidel.
Yeah, Fidel Gauguin Jr. is in, and he did that April 9th is actually when he wrote it.
I really am pleased because I could still be housebound, never seen
yeah.
out of day, but he's out there now and singing and
yeah,
doing
that's
so
fantastic.
Much better.
Yeah, exactly.
That's wonderful. Thank you for sharing that, Bernie.
Yeah. I want to mention that the Autism Resource Center, the Book Nook, is having a promotion this week. We've had them on the show a couple of times, and we've done a Book of the Month, which you've done a couple of reads. You've done them both, and you're going to give us a little review. I want to mention the promotion that they're having this week. And they have a number of children's books, which I always used to buy my children's books secondhand as well because they go through them.
No,
I'm not going to make you read those. But I mean, those people who have small children, read to them for sure. And it's a great location where you can pick up a lot of secondhand children's books for next to nothing. They actually have fill a box for $5.
Wow.
Oh, that's
so that's
great.
Their promotion this week at the Autism Resource Center, their Book Nook.
Fantastic.
People will be over there buying books for the kids.
Oh,
yeah.
Goodness, yes.
So your review on your last book.
So much, such a part
what
of
did
my
you read?
Life. I said to Veronique one day, if I got paid to read, I'd be Oprah right now. Because I can literally read 24 hours a day.
Wow.
And my sister was home from Toronto, and she said, I like to read too, but I'd prefer a really quality magazine with information on, you know, positive things.
Okay.
And she's very into that, but business. And so I said, no, me, it's novels and books.
Okay.
So I did do the one, She's Come Undone, which I have yet to bring back to you, by Wally Lamb. I gave the review on that. Beautiful book. The other one was Nights Below Station Street by David Adams Richards, formerly from Newcastle, living in Fredericton with his wife Peggy, and he's written so many, and he won the Governor General's Award in 1988 for this particular book. At first, it was like, I hate this. Sorry, David. I have to be honest here. I really wasn't into it. You know how you start, you pick up a book in the first chapter, either grabs you or it doesn't? I kept reading. I thought, I'm going to give this a chance because he's so, it's not dark, but a little bit grim, and yet it's such a realistic piece of writing that you have to appreciate it by the time the book's halfway through, and then by the time you're done, you say that was very well done.
Wow.
Oh, you're kidding.
And he's just, what you see is what you get with him. You can tell there's not a whole lot of, he's brilliant, but there's not a whole lot of premeditation in his writing. It's basically, he has his ideas. And it's just, you can almost see how vividly he writes, but just as he goes along almost.
Wow. Oh, you're kidding.
I'll have to dig into that one.
Yeah,
we
will.
You know what I mean? It's like he didn't research all his ideas. It's just so true from the heart that it's just put on paper as he thinks about it, basically. Mm-hmm. That's how I felt.
It would be true to him, because if that's how they feel and they perceive that situation, you know what I mean? For them, it would be real.
Yeah, and I never had another 544 page book on the weekend, too.
She's showing off now.
No, I'm not.
She's showing off.
I'm addicted to books, but I could be addicted to so many other things, but I'm addicted to books.
Well, and I have been an avid reader my whole life, but I find in the last couple of years I haven't taken the time, nor have I had the time, nor made the time for it. So I'm missing it. Okay. I'm hoping that once the summer is over and things slow down a little bit in the fall, I'm actually gonna.
Don't say when summer's over.
Oh my land!
We get a good summer.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's fantastic.
I'm looking forward to reading some books.
So I have stacks for you.
Good.
Okay.
Right on. The Rib Fest was this weekend. I worked all weekend. I'm not going to lie. I didn't get down there. I actually lived vicariously through everybody else who was there with the videos and their pictures and their taste testing and everything else like that. Huge numbers.
Huge.
Yes.
Huge, despite that it wasn't absolutely beautiful out. It was.
No, and Friday
night. I think it was
nicer
than last year.
Well, and I went Friday night and Saturday. I had never been to Rib Fest before.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I went Friday night to check it out, and it was cold and rainy, but my goodness, there was a ton of people there.
Yeah, there was.
Yeah, and it was.
Well, they had live entertainment.
Yes, they did. And it was in the foosball, a human foosball, and they had washer toss, and there was professional washer toss people there. And like, it was really amazing, and they had a gentleman that carved. Wood with a chainsaw. So it was like he had bears and everything he'd carved with the chainsaw right in front of you. And there was a fellow that spray painted right in front of you as well. And entertainment. And, yeah. And so we had a good time.
And tasted some good ribs.
Oh my gosh, yeah, they were delicious. And the fact that these people make a living doing this and the schedule they had to travel was incredible. But I tasted Krabby's. That was the one I kind of stuck with for the weekend. It was delicious. But I have to mention the cornbread.
Oh, I love cornbread.
I have to mention the cornbread.
She mentioned it earlier.
I know.
I'm hungry.
We got it from Texas Rangers, which was another one of the ribbers that was there. It was the size of a kitten. And it was $3, but it was worth every dollar.
It was the size of a kitten.
That turns me out somehow.
No, it was just huge, but it was so good. Mom and I each got one Friday night, and then we had them for breakfast Saturday morning. They were delicious.
The kitten the next day.
And then I dragged Dad down to the Rib Fest Saturday afternoon after we did the Walk of Hope for the Schizophrenia Society. And it was both my parents' first Rib Fest, too.
Mm-hmm. Oh, was it?
They loved it. Yeah, we had a great time.
Good. Well, I went twice. Have to cook for you then if you're going twice.
And Rotary Club of Newcastle did a phenomenal job.
Did they?
Phenomenal.
The way it was all set up and everything. Because this was their second.
Yes.
The second annual.
The amount of work. Yeah, the amount of work that they put in beforehand. And then it was like 14, 15-hour days, right? I mean, they started early.
And chilly.
Oh, goodness. Yeah. Like, they did a fantastic job.
Yes, so they should be proud.
Yeah, because we went for a drive Saturday evening, and I said, well, let's take a drive down by there. It was nighttime, and I didn't expect to see anybody then, but the music was just booming.
Yeah.
Yes. The crowd was still there.
And awesome event.
A lot of local talent. There's quite a few... like I said, if you were on Facebook at all over the weekend, there was a lot of pictures and a lot of video.
Oh, yeah.
There was a video of dancing and the local entertainment that was there that was really, really good. And I believe our producer's telling me that some of those videos will be on our Facebook page.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So we'll be able to check that out.
There was one thing that caught me by surprise. There was a little black piggy running around. He was somebody's pet.
Oh.
Okay.
He was adorable, but I just didn't think that at a Rib Festival
I would bring
my little pet.
That's not really.
He was adorable. Like, he was so cute. He was only the size of my doggy, but I was just like,
she did get to take him home.
Yes,
she,
I think
nobody
so.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
No.
The portal.
But his little tail wagged the whole time. Yeah. Like, he was just like a little doggy.
I don't really want a pet pig, but my friend Keith, I had a pet skunk.
Oh, you're kidding.
No. Defumed, obviously.
Oh. Yes,
but
obviously.
You should have seen her walking around this pet on a leash as a skunk. I'd have my little dog, and she'd have her skunk, and away we'd walk as children.
Go on.
It was pretty weird. But
I can't imagine.
The video that they're actually going to post on our Facebook page is the crowd, the dancers that got up, I believe, and danced to Justin Timberlake's song.
Oh, okay.
Or whatever. Yeah, I didn't get to see that one, but I guess it's pretty impressive.
Oh, the video, you mean?
Yeah, the video.
Oh, it's gone viral.
Yeah.
Yes, that one.
That is so catchy.
Yes, yeah.
Dance,
family's reunion. Her family member turned 90 over the weekend, and so they did this little video in celebration. It's hilarious.
And it's well done.
Yeah.
So that would be Aaron Lennon, who's Karen Lennon's daughter.
Yes, and they're dancing all over
incredible.
The sheet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
With the elderly woman, the grandmom.
Yes, I know.
At the end, making a little face.
Yes. No, I didn't. I seen it on there, but I didn't click on it yet. So no, I'll have to watch it, and it'll be on.
To.
Yeah, and it'll be on our Facebook.
Well,
page
when I spotted it this morning, and that was just early this morning, they already had 29,000 views.
29,000. No, catchy.
Almost as many views as the video that our grad class had put together that they had played that game with the balloon game kind of thing. Yeah, I had noticed that it's at the 22 million or whatever there now, something like that.
Yeah.
I wasn't there that day, so I'm like, you know.
Yeah.
I'm proud that it was my grad class, but I'm sort of.
I know. You're rolling around. Okay, 10's not too bad. 20's, it's our 25th. There, and then when it's past, oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's our 25th this summer.
Oh, that really makes me feel bad.
Yeah. We're having a big party, though. It'll be good.
I know, but if she's 25 years in, imagine how I feel.
It's all good.
No, that's just
but it is good.
Yeah.
Celebration of your graduation and your classmates.
Yeah. Well, I had just celebrated because we were on holidays last week with the long weekend, and it was my wedding anniversary.
Oh, yes,
so
right.
I
saw some beautiful pictures.
28 years.
Incredible.
So we had gone out to dinner at the casino. Mm-hmm. I call it the casino. Everybody calls it the Rec, which is the
Riverside Entertainment Center.
I call it the casino.
So do I, actually.
Yeah. And we had a lovely evening. There was local talent that was playing there, which was so impressive. I couldn't help but feel like I was back home in my father's kitchen, and they were playing guitar. And Burton Cummings' song came on. Cummings. Break It to Them Gently.
Oh, yeah.
I was like,
I saw him in concert one year.
Yes.
And he sang that. And he was so handsome back in the day.
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah. You were a beautiful bride, Audrey.
Oh,
absolutely
my goodness.
Absolutely stunning.
Young.
Still are, but you were gorgeous in your wedding gown and high cheekbones.
I think
hair.
We all had that same wedding gown that year with the high collar and the long sleeves.
Yeah, but beautiful. And, you and Billy together.
Yeah.
Congratulations on your anniversary.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yes, 28. We've been together for 30. No, I know.
Yeah.
I know. I'm like, okay, that's good. 28's good.
It's great.
No, that's just it. So what else was on deck this weekend? I heard that there was a women's bowling tournament was in town, so a lot of people had been in town for that. Yeah. I'm wondering where they put everybody.
Well, and then Sunday there was the MS walk, and then there was the Alzheimer's walk as well. So,
you
could have been 15 different places this weekend.
That's true.
Yeah, exactly.
No, it was a great weekend, I think.
She's buzzing.
Yeah,
there's always something.
It was. Well, the other big thing that happened going on that we're actually going to bring a guest on to talk about was the Striper Cup, the Bass Striper Cup.
Big event.
And Jeff MacTavish is our guest a little later on in the show, who's going to be talking to us about all of the details there and how that all went down.
Big now.
And but our next guest is Nathalie Karasek from the Karasek School of Dance. If you've never heard that name before, you're not out much.
no, you don't get out enough. You haven't heard tell that.
Yes, exactly. For me, that school goes way back. That's where I learned to dance and was joined up in that when her mom was the teacher back then.
Ellen.
But she's going to be on to talk to us about her endeavors since she took over. And
big
and
show
how
coming
the,
up, too, with the Karasek School of Dance.
Exactly.
This coming weekend,
some great
actually.
Photos and stories from of where she's been and who she's seen and who she's met.
Exciting.
It's going to be.
Longest standing school on the river.
So we'll be back with more Have a Chat. Don't go away. Hi, and welcome back to more Have a Chat. We've got a great show lined up for you today. Joining us now, we have Nathalie Karasek from Karasek School of Dance. Thank you, Nathalie, for joining us today.
Hi, ladies. How are you doing today?
Have you a dancer.
Thank you.
You're our first dancer. We've had
first instructor and dancer we've had on our show.
Yep.
Oh, that's wonderful. It's about time then, right?
It is about time, yes.
Good.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and your company.
Okay, well, the Karasek Dance Studio has been around for 44 years. My mother had the dance studio before I took it over. Mm-hmm. She arrived here. My father was in the military and was posted here, and then she decided to start a little part-time job, and it ended up becoming a big thing. And who would have known that she'd have a daughter one day that would be so involved? Yes, that's what I do every moment of my life.
I
eat, sleep, breathe it. But I love it. So I started dancing around 2.5, and with my mom.
You came out dancing, didn't you?
Oh yes, I sure did. My mother was pregnant for me when she was dancing, so I was dancing right from
bouncing in the boom.
Yes, and I danced with her. For a while, she had to actually have older students teach me because I wouldn't listen to her in class.
True. Yes.
And so I got very involved, and when I turned 18, I started going to Toronto and then later New York and taking classes all summer. I'd stay there the entire summer. And from there, I did an audition amongst about 5,000 people, and was one chosen to go on a U.S. tour.
So I
traveled throughout the summer. Toronto was the only Canadian city, and we performed in Vegas, Disneyland, Disney World, Salt Lake City, Texas. San Jose, it was amazing.
You danced your way across
Canada. Yes, I did. I loved it. It was such a big deal. And then eventually that led to me wanting more. So my mother would tell me that she loved my choreography, and I decided to release instructional dance videos. So it was wonderful. I had teachers ordering throughout Canada. My videos, and it was wonderful to know that my routines were being put on other stages throughout Canada, and I would go do workshops and Ontario, I was going in and doing workshops for dance studios. They would invite me in to choreograph for them, and and then in 1998 the videos led to someone inquiring about me adjudicating a dance competition, which was Canada's largest dance competition. I did that, and it was a great honor. I was thrilled, but it was hard. It was 10 days long.
How many adjudicators, Nathalie?
There were 5 of us. Wow. It started at 9 in the morning and went until midnight.
What?
And we gave out at least $75,000 in cash scholarships. And actually, one of the kids that was a competitor is Blake McGrath, and he was on So You Think You Can Dance, and then went on to be a choreographer and judge of So You Think You Can Dance Canada, and is a recording artist, so he's doing very well. Choreographs for big names like Janet Jackson,
you were alongside another very famous
adjudicator. Abby Lee Miller of Dance Moms. She was there, and we spent a great deal of time together. And she was as opinionated then
as she is now.
On
TV.
Oh yes,
this was before she did Dance Moms.
It was before Dance Moms, and I found her a little hard by day 10. It was a little hard to handle her because she had an opinion about everyone on the stage. Telling me that person, they had to mortgage their house twice for the competitions. She'd be talking, and we weren't supposed to look down. That we had writers for us making the corrections when we wanted to correct, tell the dancers what to work on in their numbers, and she'd be just chatting in my ear, and I'd always try to sit opposite of her because it was really hard to take. And then I ended up spending a night with her the last night at a hotel. She said, "Let's share this money, Nathalie, and split a room." And I was like, "Oh my gosh,
do I have to?"
I was so passive back then that I just said yes and did, and but it was an interesting experience and something I can talk about now.
Yeah.
And she was so proud, talking about her mom, who also, because my mom has a costume, takes care of all of our costumes now, and does costumes for other dance studios. And Abby's mom did the same thing, and so we had that in common. So it was very interesting. But my mom has a beautiful dance boutique here on the Miramichi.
She sure does.
And her costumes are gorgeous. They're just beautiful.
They are.
And yeah, so we're having our big show this coming weekend. I've been working around the clock with the kids, and it's going to be a big show.
Tell people where, Nathalie.
Okay, so it's called Let's Go Crazy. We're doing a finale. I was going to do another finale, and when Prince left the world, I decided to do a Prince finale. The show is going to be at the Carrefour this Saturday, June 4th. 2 shows, 2 o'clock and 7:30. And tickets can be purchased at Brookdale's or right there at the door, or Scott's in Chatham, or I myself have them at the Dance Boutique. And there's going to be all kinds of numbers for everyone. We deal with the Sirius. We're doing a Syrian refugee number.
Mm-hmm.
I have a big Aladdin production number.
Exciting.
So hip-hop, everything. I have something there that
all.
Every age will enjoy.
You go ahead.
I was just going to say, for someone like me who would love to be able to dance but just likes to just do my own little thing.
You did river dance. You remember that, right? You did a river dance class.
Really?
Oh, yes, we did.
Well,
I wish we had video.
There might be a photograph in there.
For someone that's not like yourself, gifted from birth.
I wouldn't say I was gifted from birth.
No,
I worked hard.
You do have talent. Is anybody teachable?
Everyone is teachable. You
think so?
And you're not going to get.
Do you not watch Dancing with the Stars?
No.
It's true. There you go. Although, you know what?
Football players
and all. There are a lot of people that go in there and they've had dance training.
Yes, of course.
Disney stars. And But yes, everyone's teachable. My mother used to want to, she will kill me for saying this, but I know she'd want to hide me behind the curtains. I was not the best dancer.
Really?
I wouldn't pay attention. I just think I didn't have the passion for it yet. Mm. And when I started to focus my energy and I realized how much I loved it, then I started to become a better dancer. But I'll tell you, I have little girls that walk into the door and they're so shy and they won't speak. Mm. And the one thing that I notice is the biggest accomplishment is having these little girls come out of themselves, yeah, and find their personalities and really be able to express themselves through the art of dance. Mm-hmm. And they learn how to dance. I have some kids graduating this year that have had 15 years of training. I have girls that come back that are on their 20th show.
Oh,
my older girls that are all in business now, and they come back and they're participating in the show. And
women.
Women. Oh, yes.
Awesome.
Yes. So it's lovely, and I'll be dancing with them in the show.
So do you finish for the summer and then start back up in the
fall? I finish for the summer. I usually try to get to New York to become re-inspired again. Mm-hmm. And I used to do conventions every summer, but I'm getting a little older now, so I am becoming quite a bit older, but I just always want to stay on top of everything that's new, so I will go and see what's happening. I want to see the new Rockette show in New York.
Oh, yes. New Rockette show.
Big deal. Me and Michaels choreographed it.
Wow.
Derek Hough had something to do with
I'd
it.
Love to see wow.
Yeah, so, but I do, I take the summer off, but I usually do some summer camps, mm-hmm, and I'm always thinking about, it makes the people in my life crazy because every time I hear a song, I'm just always thinking about what can I do next.
With that.
Yeah.
Your mind doesn't shut down. Do you have a favorite dancer?
A favorite dancer? Oh, from...
Somebody you love to watch.
Not my kids.
No.
They will tell you that, yes, Nathalie has her favorites. I love all
no,
my girls.
No, no. I mean, outside of this, boys, of your dance school, like
someone
that you watch.
I love... there's so many that I love through the years. I loved Patrick Swayze. I got to meet him, and that was a joy. I have a picture with him.
That's pretty awesome.
Loved him, and Debbie Allen, the classics.
Mm, yes. Michael Jackson.
No, Michael Jackson, loved him. And I have a great deal of respect for, all these people, these young people now, Derek Hough and Julianne Hough, and what they do with the choreography. There's so many people. I've had the opportunity to dance with, there was someone who was a big part of my life. His name was Al Gilbert. And he created a curriculum, a syllabus that went throughout the world. He was known as a Pied Piper of dance. Mm. You would have done technique with him. Mm. And it was tap, jazz, and ballet. And I toured with him. I got to spend a great deal of time. He had a studio in LA. And actually, Christina Applegate and I met after Sweet Charity.
Beautiful.
And we had the best conversation about how we both danced with Al. Mm. And we had stories to share. And so, he's somebody. He's gone now. Mm-hmm. But I'm telling you what a mark he left on the world.
Let's show the gorgeous Nathalie here in her beautiful
costume. Pictures.
That is beautiful. That's when you were starting out teaching your own school.
Yeah. No, that's when I was in New York. I was just, I went for professional shots in New York. I went and had the other. Those are just different things from the paper throughout the years. Mm-hmm. And
Nathalie, do you still have the same, like you're saying, you're caught up in every moment of thinking what's next, but do you still have the exact same passion you had like 20 years ago?
I have more of a passion for it. I feel I've become a better choreographer and a better teacher. Mm-hmm. I can't do all that I do now as a dancer. I dance with the girls. We're doing Adele's Hello, and we're playing sort of spirits on the other side, trying to contact Kelsey. All the older girls will be doing that with me. And, I still definitely have the passion. As I said, I believe it's more so. But I also get tired. I do it all myself.
I
have assistant teachers, but I have no one else that goes in that teaches for me full time. And it's only when I'm sick do I leave someone, to teach.
Incredible.
And I do all the choreography myself. But so I get tired sometimes, and every once in a while I get caught up, like, at the drama
of course,
the moms
and
the kids, the teens. But that's probably more like what I find the most difficult. Mm-hmm. But I love them, and honestly, I have beautiful kids and beautiful moms that are just mostly right there to lend a helping hand constantly. So, we call it the dance family. Like, this is our dance family.
Yes.
And, so those are my kids. Some of them I deal with. I teach them 4 days a week. Some of them dance 12, 13 hours a week.
Yeah, you must feel so fit and wonderful about their just bodies beautiful. And shape.
They shock you, some of these kids at 9 years old, what they can do. It's
well, I can remember.
So impressed with
it
them.
Is. The children are just amazing. And when you see them on stage and what the passion, she shares that and you know, it's embedded in the children and they show it in their performance.
Yeah, I try. Like that's, I'm very excited about that because I'm opening up to them to things that they would not see just being on the Mare Machine.
No.
You know, I've seen Wicked 10 times. It's my favorite Broadway show now. I have kids going to New York that are now, that's what they're going to see because they've heard me talk about it so often.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so I try to open them up to all these artistic, you know, these things that they wouldn't see here. But also, I feel I really try to teach the kids values to how to respect themselves, how to respect other people, and, you know, we're at a new time. I find it's one extreme to the next with kids today. Yeah. You know?
Do you take new students?
Like, oh, I do, yes. I take new students. I take them at 2.5, and I've even had adult classes going on that were beginners.
Okay, so 24.5, I can join? I'll be there next week.
Don't laugh. It wasn't that long ago after I graduated from hair school. I had joined a class, a bunch of us girls from Genesis, and it was our girl time.
Uh-huh.
It was.
We had a good time
that
in there.
First night, Natalie's like, shake what your mama gave you. And we were all just like,
that
okay.
That is my thing.
We enjoyed it. For us, it was a night out, and it was some exercise, and it was girl bonding, and you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was fantastic. And then, of course, at the end, and we actually learned a routine, and she was like, okay, let's do that on stage. And we're like, yeah, no. No.
We're like, and everyone felt better when they left. They show up, and they're like, I had to drag my sorry butt out of the house, and, you know, cold winter's night, and they would all leave, like, just hyped up.
So liberating.
Their husbands were very happy to see them come home because they were all energetic.
That's right.
Full of life again. But it was, I enjoy that too. And you know, I can say things in my adult classes that I can't get away with saying.
Just like we on TV. Ones, you know. We say things before the
commercial
camera.
Break.
That's right.
I'm like, we don't say anything.
No, the commercial breaks are different. Yeah.
Oh my gosh, we're live. So Natalie, it must be challenging, however, to try to come up with different choreography moves.
Yeah, sometimes, like I just finished last night. I choreographed until midnight last night, and I started at 4, and it was one of those days that did not stop. It was our last costume fitting day and props, and our lad number is like 25 minutes long. It's a whole story from the Broadway show. So we were pretty busy. Everything went really well, but finished that choreography up. And I do find at this point, you know, we have 34 numbers, but then when you add up all the numbers with Aladdin and the finale, sometimes I get burnt out for sure. There'll be times I'm in the studio until 2 a.m. working on the choreography, and it takes me a while to get into it. So when the kids are really thrilled with what I give them, and I see the young adults really excited, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, that's great, and hey, I might still have it.
It's
you know, because I get so excited about it, I know I'm doing something right. Some of these kids are in 14 numbers, and if they're getting excited, it means I'm giving them something that's a little fresh.
Yeah.
So
you know?
How long would it take to get costumes prepared and fitted and all of that for this
it's
show?
A lot, it can be a lot of work. You know, I sort of make notes of what I would like, what I picture, and then my mom spends hours preparing the costumes. She designs them. This year we ordered some costumes, but... She does beautiful designs too. Gorgeous.
They're stunning every year.
How long does it take you to put together a show? Like, would it be a couple of months?
It took me 9 months.
Well,
I last
baby.
Night.
I'm like,
do you know how old I am?
Do a dance show.
Have you seen one of the shows? It is like,
oh
a
my
baby.
Gosh, it is. That's my puppy's my baby.
She is Bella.
Bella, but no, it's a big process. I mean, I don't wing too much. I'm pretty prepared when I go in, and I'm really excited. I mean, I feel like this is going to be. It's a very professional show. And, you know, I'm hoping people come out to see it because there's a lot of talent here on the Miramichi. And I know you sit through so many shows, you know, piano recitals and different things. And well, you know, but this is something different. And every number that comes on is so different.
Yes.
There'll be Disney dances that are light and fluffy, and then there'll be hip-hop numbers. I do point routines, ballet point routines. And at my studio... which really is you have to have the proper training before you go on point. if you're in a dance studio that just puts you on to point shoes, that's not the right thing.
No.
Like,
yeah.
The kids have to be properly trained
there is
before
a process,
they go on.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. If I was to take all the kids that called me and just wanted to be on point, I'd have, you know, so many more. But, yeah, a professional studio doesn't do that. So
now before we wrap up,
yes.
You have to tell us again about the show. So it's only how much?
Yes,
$20?
It's $20
That's
a ticket
amazing.
In advance. And as I said, it's this weekend.
Carpe Beau Soleil.
2 and 7 o'clock. I hope I didn't say 7:30 a while ago.
Two.
They used to be 7:30. 2 and 7 p.m.
Okay.
And
on Saturday and Sunday?
Just Saturday.
Just Saturday. There's the
two
shows.
June 4th.
Yes, June 4th. And we have a beautiful opening number, a Marilyn Monroe. They look like pinup girls.
Wow.
And we do deal with everything. There's something in there for everyone.
So
be there or be square.
Yeah. Yes.
And registration for the following season?
Yes, it would be Labor Day Monday. That's tradition.
Okay.
Labor Day Monday. Yeah.
If anyone's interested, and you do take new students if
they're interested. Oh, yes,
of course.
You want to join
if there's anyone.
That's the future of the studio right there.
I was a ballroom dancer for a bit.
Were you really?
Yeah.
Well, that's interesting.
And I was
that's
a river
fantastic.
Dancer. I mean, and you dance so well. I
danced for years when I was little.
Well,
I just loved it.
We should have prepared a routine.
Oh, no. Yeah, I don't think that's a video we'd put on our Facebook page.
There'd be a lot of views, I guarantee it.
But you're to be commended, Nathalie, on work, your instruction, choreography, and your shows are tremendous, and your students love it, and they love you.
Oh, exactly. Thank you so much.
Thanks again for joining us. We'll be back with more Have a Chat with another great guest.
Thank you.
Jeff MacTavish.
Don't go away.
Hi, and welcome back to Have a Chat. I'm Audrey Lynch. Vero and Judy still with us, and joining us up next is our next guest, Jeff MacTavish. Hello, Jeff.
Hi, ladies.
Welcome on this rainy day.
Yes.
Thank you very much for having me.
Nice and bright.
Thank you.
I know, we're a good bright panel.
We're not bad. I'm still in my shades of gray.
Well, we never consult what we're going to wear with each other.
No,
we
don't.
With whatever, so.
No, and it's working so far.
Could have been a raincoat today, but here we are.
I'm flexible.
Yes. You're here to talk to us today about the Bass Striper Cup that went on this past weekend here in Miramichi.
Yeah, we had, this is our second annual Miramichi Striper Cup.
Mm-hmm.
Last year, we had a phenomenal tournament, or we thought we did.
Yes.
This year, we really knocked it out of the park. We had an extra 70 boats show up to Miramichi this year that registered.
Wow.
So that brought us up to 189 vessels on the river.
Wow.
We had 980-some individuals register to fish from the shore.
Gee.
And we had about 250 kids, which is up 100 kids from last year. So
that's insane. What age group of kids?
We have kids can participate in the individual division as far as youth goes, but age 16 and under can register for free to make it inclusive.
Oh, here's a video.
There's a bit of video on the launch and everything.
Of people getting into the water. Is there, when you tell us how many boats were actually in the water, I'm like, would there be a limit where we're like, okay, that's too many? Because it's unsafe.
Fear of crashing into each other.
Because some of the video of when they were starting off, that was my fear was, there's so many, how do they, you know,
control it?
Because, you know, make sure nobody bumps into anybody.
You can tell that we don't fish. Right?
I know, I'm how does that all go?
With that question, you can tell that none of us fish, right?
Well, every operator of the vehicle, of the boat, is responsible for two things, what's called wake and wash, and that's the water that flies off the sides of the boat and the water that comes off the back of the boat. So they have to be careful with the boats beside them. They have to be always, and it's Transport Canada rules. It's not Miramichi Striper Cup rules. So it's kind of like driving on the street. We drive on one side of the yellow line as opposed to our friends on the other side.
We hope we do anyway.
They really have to be responsible for the way they operate their vessels, and these guys are here to compete. They're competitive people. Yes, they want to be the first ones off the gate, much like a drag racer or anything like that.
They want to be.
But they're also cognizant that there's little boats out there. So we have orientation sessions on Friday evening, the official event starts, and we go through the rules, the regulations,
and what we want
to see really take place on the safety side.
Yeah.
So in total, how many people did you have registered for the weekend?
We had, in total, including kids, boat members, and the boat members, we average out at three people per boat.
Yes.
Most people, some people had four, some people had two, but we average it out at three. So we had about 1,808 participants.
Wow. Incredible. Wow. There's some officials on MLA.
Yes. Yes.
Our good mayor and Minister Frazier.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had MLA Harris, Minister Frazier, and the mayor out to light the signal flare during the event.
I love that video.
Look at this. Our river is so beautiful. We're utilizing it for something great. Yeah. It's second annual.
Yeah, and it's expected to get bigger. Now, one of the things that we've discovered over the weekend, and we weren't aware of this last year, is the Miramichi Striper Cup may actually be Canada's largest fishing tournament.
No,
wow.
That is exciting.
We kind of brand ourselves Atlantic Canada's premier fishing tournament, mm-hmm. or bass fishing tournament.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But now we might be able to label it Canada's largest fishing tournament.
So it can only grow from there, really.
Well, go back to your question about where the limit is.
Yeah.
Once you creep up to about 250 boats in that river, it can get a little tricky. So what we may have to look at in the future is there's some people that are very competitive and they're going to go and find the fish no matter where it takes them, right? We do have boundaries that they have to stay within, but they're going to make their way upriver towards Sunny Corner and those areas. But then there's other participants that really just want to be part of it. They want to support the event, and we're very thankful for both groups.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But we may have to look at more of a family-oriented division, too. So keep the price a little bit lower, but allow more people on boats and allow them to get out and enjoy what a great recreational fishery we have.
Mm-hmm. So the economic spinoff from a weekend like this is beyond imaginable, right?
Yeah.
For the businesses, like for hotels, I'm sure, and restaurants, and just shopping and everything in general, right?
We actually have a formula, a program that we use to estimate what the impact was. So last year, just for example, with about 600 less participants, the economic impact was about $500,000 for the province.
Oh, wow,
and
nice.
Majority of it taking place in Miramichi, so about 400,000. Right. These are just rough numbers. I have the exact ones.
Right.
But you add, like, that was 1,200 participants last year. We added an extra 600 participants this year. So, you know, that's one-third of the total that we went up. It's great growth to have.
And, I'm excited.
So by of course, the tournament ended last night. So hopefully by the end of this week, I'll be able to plug those numbers in.
Mm-hmm.
We attracted people from Alberta, from South Carolina, Quebec, Ontario, Nova Scotia.
Any big names out there? Any sports figures or anybody that I know that we have people fishing all over the world in our beautiful river, but... Anyone?
Well, I happened to take one registration from an NHL superstar, but we'll just leave him nameless.
Yeah.
Local boy, but he came home.
That's
and
awesome.
His hockey season's over for this year.
Beautiful.
And so he ended up signing a registration for him.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Fishing's so big this year. My son's been fishing every night of the week. I said, what about your homework?
Yeah.
He's not want to fish.
No.
So it's catching on.
Trying to bring, literally catching on.
Oh, okay. Yeah. No pun intended, but they're out in the water. My friends are out fishing.
Oh, yeah.
It's wonderful.
And the weather wasn't absolutely beautiful. It was a little nicer, I think, than last year. And it's still, diehard fishermen out there.
Those guys are prepared.
Fisher people.
Those folks, you're right, are prepared.
they
come suited up. You should have seen some of the, people spend money, not only on the boat and their tackle and their rods and
their
reels.
Their gear.
But they are dressed to the nines. They've got the team, jerseys like this.
I've seen that. That some of the teams put together had uniforms almost.
They do. And they take it very seriously. And then there's others that, go to, Sam's Graphics or one of the local
print shops
and get a little t-shirt done up and put their name on it. And same effect. They're really there to compete. And they're really there to be, show the camaraderie.
So they're there for the striper bass striped bass.
Striped bass, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it goes by different names. It's rockfish also, right? A name for that is rockfish.
Perhaps, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
and
you know more about fishing.
She did her research.
I know. Striped bass, though, is very good. It's really, really low in calorie and really, really high in protein.
Oh, it's delicious.
It is.
Oh, and is
it's
it?
Like,
oh,
low calorie.
Never tried
3
it.
3 ounces of bass is about, it's nothing in calories, but you get your omega fatty acids, 650 grams in 3 ounces.
Did you know all of that?
Oh, no. Yes, yeah.
I love fish.
Yeah.
So it's high protein and low cal.
So let's talk, just not to change it, but the prizes that were given away. The winners.
So, that goes back to our sponsors, right? So one of the things that we really raise our participation is we have a great sponsor that donates a boat. a motor and a trailer.
Incredible.
And this year it was Miramichi Marine, Paul Murdoch and his crew. Right. So a big shout out to them.
Yes, mm-hmm.
They
definitely
put together a wonderful package, which was a Prince Craft Resorter boat, 40 horsepower motor from Mercury.
Jeez.
And Miramichi Marine basically brought the trailer in and took care of all that.
And it was more than $20,000, as a prize package?
It was just close to 20. Yeah. That boat would...
Generous.
You could get $20,000 for that boat for sure.
Beautiful.
Yeah. And it's a great package. So all paid participants are eligible. We put all their names in a hat. It's the last thing we do at the end of the night. So we pulled that ticket out, and Miramichi, Don McCullum won that boat last night.
Good old
Miramichi. Yeah. Second year in a row, we had a young fella.
He was only 18, wasn't he?
16
years old. Yep. Was the winner last year.
Yeah. Now he sold that boat and
bought a car.
He said his girlfriend wasn't very happy with the thought of driving down from South Esk on the
boat.
So.
You think?
Yeah.
But that is so nice. Yeah. Like, there's so much happening. Yeah. So you particularly went out and chose this for yourself, did you, or did they honor you with this jacket hoodie?
This is something that we get designed for the coordinators, which has a lot of our prime sponsors on it. So,
you talk about,
other than the cash, because we gave out a lot of cash this weekend too, but we gave out rods and reel packages from Shimano, Brass Pro Shop, who was one of the first guys on board last year, gave us about $7,000 worth of outdoor gear. So
incredible.
Sleeping bags, jackets, rain suits, nice chairs, bags.
Well, without those sponsors, it just couldn't happen, right?
Well, it could happen, but
without them, it would be tough.
Yeah, I really don't think that you would attract the numbers, because people aren't only there to fish, although that's great, but they want the trophy, they want the prize, the recognition, and they like to walk away with
bragging
something.
Right.
So.
And the experience, too, of the weekend, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Like, social, too. Oh,
yeah. If you were to go down there, it was just our logo on there. What those big names like Bass Pro, Shimano, Sims, all those outside companies, let's call them, that come in and contributed Prince Craft Mercury, they add brand recognition to our tournament. Yeah. So it's credibility that they're giving us because they're being associated with it. So when you see those names as an angler, you say, hey, there must be really something to this. And
that's the real deal.
We have received nothing but positive comments from people from all outside the province that compete competitively. They say this is one of the best fisheries in Canada.
Beautiful.
And they say this was one of the best run tournaments in Canada.
Really well organized.
Yeah. Well, and I love the fact that it was the same weekend as the Rib Fest, because you really fed off each other. You and I were talking about it earlier. The people that were coming off the river after a day of fishing were heading right over to Rib Fest to enjoy it there.
Every time a boat would come in, that was the little plug that we gave them. So we did partner in a way with the Newcastle Rotary Club, is that we, a non-competition clause. So they handled all the entertainment. They handled all the food. Mm-hmm. They also provided some alcoholic beverages with their beer tent.
There was a tent,
And we stayed right out of that business. So when anyone would come off the boat, we would certainly, we'd weigh their score. We'd have a little conversation with them, and we'd send them over and say, hey, don't forget to go over to Rib Fest. So, hopefully we were sending people over there, and vice versa. We had people from Rib Fest walking across the street to see what all the excitement was on the weigh-ins for the fish and things like that. So it was a partnership made in heaven. So,
Well, it was delicious, and it was so exciting to see the videos on Facebook, but to be driving, from one side of the river to the other and see all the boats out there, to see the people on the shore and to know that, families were out there. And it really was a beehive of activity for the weekend.
Well, we'd set up the curling club for the reception on Friday and then the award ceremony on Sunday.
The awards.
And it was standing room only.
Well, you could tell because as you were driving down past French Fort Cove, I mean, there was cars lined up, on the road. They were everywhere. Like, it was quite phenomenal.
Now, next year, do you have to put a cap on the attendance? Because it's going to keep growing. I mean, our river is so big. But, we do have to have, like you said, if it's multiplied by 600 more memberships this time.
That's a good problem to have. We'll see. Friday of last week, I was really nervous because when I looked at the numbers compared to last year, I was wondering, did I do something wrong? Because we only had like 80 boats, 100 people registered. And in true Miramichi fashion, everyone showed up and we had the whole curling club wrapped.
There.
Wild.
More video.
Look at this, our good
everybody.
Yeah. Well, and that, of course, that is we're known for that here in the Miramichi, that we tend to be last minute.
Yep.
you know, which is tough. It's tough for organizational purposes, right? When you're trying to put something like this together or anything, it's really tough when we wait until that last minute when we're, you know, when we're selling tickets and everything. But also in true Mary Michi style, we all came out.
Absolutely. And that's exactly what I mean. We had a phenomenal turnout from the local residents and a great, again, from the province. Because it's interesting, again, looking at the numbers, we could see where they were from. And it was mostly outside people that were registering early to get their spot.
Sure.
Because when we're doing our promotion, we say, you know, space is limited, space is limited. We don't say what the limit is, but we just say space is limited.
Right.
So,
exactly.
And people buy into that and they register, which gives us a little bit of confidence that, you know, that we're going to have a great event. If we could sustain the tournament at this level, I think everyone would be happy. But all indications are we're going to get swamped from Quebec last year because the teams from Quebec are, they were, let's say there was 5 last year. There was 20 this year. There's going to be 40. So,
And we're not far. It is a good weekend to come down and experience it.
These guys, these competitive fishermen from Quebec, will travel 7 hours north of Montreal to compete in a tournament. And you know what the uplands of Quebec are like. They're very, very rural.
Wow.
And so they'll go up there just for a great fishery. And everyone, all of the film crews that we've had in here, we had 3 film crews in this last 2 weeks. And they say there's nothing in Canada like this fishery.
Really? Well, how exciting is that?
Yeah.
What was the biggest? The biggest. What measured?
So in the length division, I'm just going to take a rough guess here because I don't know the exact number, but I believe it was 88 centimeters, and it was a local fisherman that won that. And then on the team, so it's two. Okay. One's length, that's the individuals, because it's easy. People can just submit a photo with a tape measure.
Oh, right, of course.
Okay. Oh, that's a big fish.
That's a big one.
Yeah.
I'm not good with
centimeters. No, I know. I'm like, we're like, somebody convert that.
I can't make the conversion from feet to centimeters, so I don't know
I can, and that's a
Well, it's almost up to your hip. So if you think about, if you have that tail on the ground, and you know.
That's good for me.
It's a good meal, actually.
Billy Flieger, one of our councils of Buckle Walsh, would be over their head.
We won't show them the clip of this.
No, but for me, it'd be up to my hip.
Yeah. Okay. So the other division is what?
Is a weight division. So each team's allowed to weigh 2 fish on Saturday and 2 fish on Sunday.
Oh, okay.
And the heaviest fish was 18 point some pounds.
Oh, wow.
And that team actually won the tournament. They had 51 pounds in total. They had some phenomenal. Wow. They're from Rishabakhtu or the Bakhtush area.
Yes, I saw that.
And wonderful folks. They were so easy to talk to and, you know, we would be, when they were sitting on the dock, we had to hold the boats down there and waiting for them to get their fish on, and then they get back on the boat and they go load up, right? And just they were so excited. You just feel the energy because we couldn't really see what they put into the bins until they get up on the stage, and then they lift them out of the tanks. And really, the guy that was carrying them up both times was straining. He had to carry that 18 pounder in one hand and then another.
Wow, buddy, there.
Oh, they're great fish.
Well, I love what this has done for the city.
Me too.
You know, like
me
just
too.
The feeling all over the river.
The excitement
this weekend was incredible, and I love what that's done for the city. And I'm not a fisher person.
But
I loved it, and I can't wait till next year.
And you were one of the key organizers, Jeff. Like, did you spearhead this with another couple of people initially? Or
well, you know, we talked about Ribfest a little bit earlier, and the Newcastle Rotary Club had a choice to make, and either they were going to host a bass fishing tournament that weekend last year, or they were going to host a Ribfest.
Okay.
And when they decided to go Ribfest, we had been talking about it, and I said, "Do you have a problem with me stealing this idea and starting to run with it?" And I brought it to my committee chair. At city council, my city manager, they said,
giddy up,
let's do it. And then,
I feel so proud.
But I can't do it alone, so I have partners, staff, all of the other city departments that help the police. Oh, absolutely. And there's three sets of volunteers I really have to say thank you to.
Okay.
And that's the Kinsman Club of Miramichi. They did all of our boat inspections for us, and thank you very much for that. The Miramichi Ground Search and Rescue, who did traffic control, making sure boats are coming in safely and they were getting pulled up and down the ramps. And our MyPi crew that helped out with registration. So we had 4 volunteers from MyPi come up and help us register and get people in the system.
So well done.
Thank you so much, Jeff, for joining us,
filling
us all in on everything.
Congratulations.
Thank you for joining us at Have a Chat. We'll see you again next week. Thanks for joining us.